of the 15th annual convention of NAREDCO. We are all present here to deliberate into discussions regarding the real estate sector in the country. And we have just been joined by our chief guest for the day, ladies and gentlemen, Honorable Minister of State, Independent Charge of Housing and Urban Affairs and Civil Aviation and Minister of State for Commerce, Industry, Government of India, Shri Hardeep Singh Puriji. Welcome you, sir. Thank you very much for taking time out and joining us here today. Also, our guest of honor for today, Shri P.K. Gupta, Managing Director for SBI, joining us on stage. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together and let's extend a very warm welcome to our chief guest for the day and our guest of honor. And also joining us on stage is Shri Niranjan Hiranandani Ji, President NAREDCO, co-founder and managing director for Hiranandani Group. We have Shri Praveen Jain, Vice Chairman NAREDCO and CMD, Tulip Infratech Private Limited, Shri Gaurav Jain, Vice President North NAREDCO and Managing Director, Samyak Properties and Infrastructure Private Limited, and also Shri Rajan Bandhelkar, Vice President West NAREDCO and Managing Director for Rona Group. Welcome everybody on stage. And now, without any further ado, I would like to invite Shri Niranjan Hiranandani Ji to kindly join us for the welcome address. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together and let's welcome, sir.
Some people come, some people are sent, but some people are God-sent. So we have Mr. Hardeep Puri, the Minister for Housing and Civil Aviation. He is God-sent to the industry. The last couple of years that we have had an interaction with him, the leadership that he has shown in the housing industry and the paradigm which the Prime Minister has set for housing for all, and the affordable housing segment has seen multiple changes that have been done, which is infrastructure status, the tax-free situation, the giving of more funds into this sector, the growth of it, the amendment in terms of GST, and all these factors have been godsend to the industry. Sir, welcome, and thank you very much for being that person and messiah for the industry to provide Roti Kapra Makan. The Makan which was not available is going to be available in the next 3 years for housing for all in the direction of the Prime Minister, which has done. Let me give you a specific example of the greatness that he has done. A month ago, Mr. Hardeep Puri had come over there in Mumbai, in the state guest house of Maharashtra in Malabar Hill, along with Mr. Piyush Goyal and the Chief Minister, Mr. Devendra Fadnavis. And he said that we need to kickstart and restart the economy in terms of the state. And he was a partner in that meeting that we attended along with NAREDCO and the government, the Municipal Commissioner, the Chief Secretary, and the entire ammunition of people who were sitting over there. And he spent a good 2 hours in terms of discussion as to what are the issues which the industry had in the city state of Maharashtra. Can you believe it? Sir, I'm very happy to announce to you that the Maharashtra government has yesterday notified a 35% reduction in all the taxes and fees which are there in the city and suburbs of Greater Mumbai. And that was initiated in the meeting which Mr. Hardeep Puri initiated and chaired on that particular day. Sir, we cannot tell you how grateful we are for the direction in which you have been able to set this thing which is there. The third thing which I wanted to mention was that there are innovations happening in the mind of Mr. Hardeep Puri every day. And this is something which we see and we really gladdens our heart. In the last 1 month, you must have heard in the finance minister's speech in the budget of talking about a rental housing policy. However, Mr. Hardeep Puri and the ministry has been able to put out the policy on day one of the budget speech, a policy which states how the rental housing policy of the government will be reading, and this was put on the website on the same day as the budget speech was made. Normally, the policy and implementation and other things follow on months and months and months later to what is the announcement. Sir, my heartiest congratulations on the speed at which you are talking about rental housing policy, which will make a paradigm difference to India, which will make a difference in order to see that people who will get housing from their ownership or rental or both, and I think this is a new paradigm which has been brought about by your ministry, which is really going to be making a difference. The other point which I wanted to state was the new idea of seeing to it that the GDP growth of $5 trillion will be taken up the ministry. Mr. Hardeep Puri has been at the cutting edge of these thoughts as to how the sector, and we will look forward to his initiative and thought process as to how this $5 trillion economy will be done, which is the target of the Prime Minister, and how the housing sector is really done. He has been sharing this discussion with me, and we are really proud that our sector should be a good participant to take care of it. Yes, sir. We cannot but keep on talking about what you have done. The skilling sector, just before I came into this stage, I was questioned in the ante room over here just now by the Honorable Minister as to what is the proposition of the skilling program, what are the hurdles for the skilling program, and how can we, this industry, take it forward, and what are the issues critical in order to make the skilling program of this country successful in the ministry. Sir, I can go on for hours and hours for this discussion, but today we have not come to hear me in the morning. We have to come to hear you in this morning, and we look forward to your direction, your statement to take India forward in order to save industry in this negative mood of crisis, of financial crisis which is there. Let me add a final one meeting. Mr. Hardeep Puri, Honorable Minister, arranged a special meeting on Sunday morning with the Prime Minister, with the Finance Minister of India, to take up the issues relating to housing and how to kickstart the economy. I can go on and on, but ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much, and we welcome the Honorable Minister with all good heart and soul that we have in this industry. We at NAREDCO promise you that we will do our level best to see to it that the objectives which your ministry has taken up is successful, fulfilling, and complete. Thank you very much for your blessings and good wishes.
Thank you very much, sir, for sharing with us the latest initiatives and updates in the real estate scenario in the country, and also shedding some light on the initiatives taken by sir, our chief guest for the day in the sector. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to request and invite Sri Rajiv Talwar, Chairman NAREDCO and CEO DLF Limited, to kindly join us to share a brief industry perspective. Please put your hands together. Let's welcome Mr. Talwar. Welcome you.
Honorable Minister, Sri Hardeep Singh Puri, not only a teacher, friend, philosopher, guide for all my life, but really the patron saint of the real estate, housing and construction sector in this country, and more so for NAREDCO. NAREDCO has almost resumed its previous role, sir, under your leadership, which was as a sponsored body of the ministry itself. And whether it is the global housing technology challenge, whether it is the rental policy, as Niranjanji said, or whether it is any demand, it's a frequent sight for the leadership of NAREDCO to be constantly present with the ministry, the officials of the ministry, and constantly preparing papers, because normally we are a step behind what the minister is saying. He is absolutely a recipient of ideas, a generator of ideas, And the entire industry has been the beneficiary, not only of the Prime Minister's vision of housing for all, but the programs which the Minister has taken up, whether it is Housing for All, Prime Minister's Awas Yojana, whether it is the Smart Cities program, all those constantly, while also listening to the demands, the analysis, and the requirements of our sector. It's been a great time for us to see that in very difficult times, the industry has still managed to make not only a living, but also progress further. And I can vouch for it, sir, that whereas we were down to something like 10 to 12 million square feet of construction by cutting down over a period of 7 to 8 years from 2008, we are now inching back to something like 35 to 40 million square feet of construction ongoing all over the country, thanks to what is the fillip and the encouragement given by the ministry. We also have with us Mr. P.K. Gupta, the Managing Director of the State Bank of India, who I must confess, I just learned from him that he belongs and he's risen in the State Bank of India from the same circle that I joined my first employment in, which was Ahmedabad circle. So both of us can share some notes in Gujarati. Thodu thodu mane pan aavade chhe sahib. So this is a great beginning for our industry. We are hoping that yes, we will not only partake in the 90% of the cake, which is affordable housing, we will also go hand in hand, shoulder and shoulder to shoulder on the global housing technology challenge, imbibing more technologies from abroad, making construction faster, cheaper, more durable, more sustainable, protecting the environment. And then we hope that yes, we will give you results in this country, which the Prime Minister looks up to, which Mr. Amit Shah looks up to, and most of all, which are guided, handheld, and constantly monitored by our Minister, Shri Hardeep Singh Puri. May I welcome him to this August gathering, and please let us hope that he throws more models like he did in the first meeting in 2017. He shot straight from Delhi to Mumbai, announced 8 models of public-private partnership, and we haven't looked back after that. I welcome you, sir. I welcome you, Mr. Gupta, and I welcome all of you to listen to something which undoubtedly will not only increase trade and commerce internationally, nationally in the country, but hopefully will also make Indian economy and the Indian nation fly as high as the civil aviation wants to go. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Talwar. And now, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to request and invite our guest of honor for the day, Shri P.K. Gupta Ji, Managing Director. My apologies. So now I would like to request and invite our chief guest for the day, Shri Hardeep Singh Puri Ji, to kindly join us and share his thoughts. Ladies and gentlemen, a thunderous round of applause to Sir.
Thank you, Niranjan. Thank you, Rajiv. Rajan, Mr. Gupta, Mr. Jain, two Mr. Jains. Ladies and gentlemen, it's always a pleasure to start the day with Niranjan, also Rajiv, because he gives you credit for just being present at an event. There are two or three things he spoke about. Let me dispose those off quickly. Yes, I think the announcements made by the Chief Minister of Maharashtra in respect of the real estate sector and number of important announcements which were notified yesterday and which have hit the Mumbai press today are really significant and noteworthy. And I congratulate the Chief Minister and through him all those who were responsible for that decision making. Yes, my senior colleague Piyush Ji and I were both present in Mumbai that morning. We sat through a 2-hour meeting, but in my long professional life, 40 years in the Foreign Service and 3 or 4 years after that, I've sat through many meetings and taken a lot of decisions, but I'm always reassured when those decisions fructify into implemented and notified policy. And I think I congratulate all of them. My limited role was to be present there and to give it whatever little support I could in terms of the overall ecosystem. Rental housing, Niranjan gave us credit for having the policy up on the net almost the day that Nirmala ji presented the budget. The facts are that I've been pushing this, in fact, even during the first Modi term. We had actually had consultations with the state governments. I remember Chief Minister of Maharashtra was present when these consultations were held in Arunji's room. And we were ready to go, but you know, everything doesn't get the priority. So we were only looking for an opportunity, and when Nirmala ji included this in the budget speech, we had the policy up on the net. I can report to you that the feedback I have as of about a week ago when I last reviewed it, that about 400 or so reactions which have come in, almost all of them were very positive. There are some concerns, but you know, this is a template, and the state governments will have to take the call on how, whether they move ahead and how. But I think it's something fantastic. If we get the, now that is the main subject of our interaction this morning, if we get the housing for all project going, as I have no doubt we will, we have rental policy in place, and we have several other decisions which I am hoping. There was a meeting which Niranjan referred to, which the finance minister took on a Sunday afternoon, and I'm sure all these decisions together will help revive or kickstart this segment, this important segment of our economy. One thing that I will take a little credit for is that I was courageous a few days after being appointed minister on 3rd September 2017. I showed the courage to attend a meeting which Niranjan had convened in Mumbai. And I think I also took the courage because I didn't know these gentlemen too well. And I, you know, when you are new in a job, and we were just formulating a policy on public-private partnership, and of those 8 models for affordable housing and partnership, I took the courage to unveil those 8 permutations there, 6 to be run by the government and 2 by the private sector providing land. And I think looking back at where we were then and where we are now, between September 2017 and it's nearly 2 years, we've traveled a long distance. But let me come to the subject of this morning's discussion. I think the fact that Prime Minister Modi is the first Prime Minister who has taken the very bold step of embracing urbanization as a win-win, I think that's given. I think our mental preoccupation for several decades prior to Mr. Modi's becoming Prime Minister seemed to either relegate urban space to a lower priority, or we were so preoccupied with agriculture and rural development that we forgot that today the urban space, in fact, does not only provide a win-win, but there's no option. Niranjan's thesis of the transition to a $5 trillion economy requiring 10 to 12% rates of growth, and that the real estate sector necessarily being the fulcrum or the platform on which this growth can be structured, I am in agreement with him. I'm in agreement with him. I have, in fact, said so all along, except that you will forgive me, since I'm presently looking at that prism through the eyes of somebody in the government, looking out towards the private sector, I'm very clear in my mind that in order to be able to achieve that 10-12% rate of growth, you need all the economic stakeholders on board, and you need the construction in industry to step up. Now, we are looking at something like 40% of India's population, or 600 million people, residing in urban areas by 2030. That is a time when the United Nations will complete the work on the Sustainable Development Goals, or the 2030 Agenda, as they call it. I have maintained for long that the previous set of goals, or what were described as the Millennium Development Goals, they succeeded largely because a large country like China was able to lift hundreds of millions of people out of poverty with a little help from countries like India, Nigeria, and other developing countries. But the success of the 2030 Agenda or the SDGs essentially rests on India's shoulders. And I have, in fact, taken the liberty of telling the Secretary General when the Prime Minister asked me to accompany him when he had come to India, and we were going to Amritsar. He wanted to visit and pay his respects to Darbar Sahib. I told him, and I've had the privilege of knowing him much before he became Secretary General, I said, in the case of the 2030 Agenda, this will succeed because India will succeed. And India will deliver on the 2030 Agenda well before the 2030 date. Now, so I come to housing for all, and which is a target which the government has set for itself for completion by 2022. What does that mean? We did a demand assessment, and according to that, we need to build some 1 crore homes by 2022. We have had to revise that assessment, and the figure now is 1 crore 12 lakhs. In other words, we have to build about 10 million plus homes. But the good news is that the Committee for Monitoring and Sanctioning of Projects, which is headed by the Secretary in my ministry, they meet every month, and I think they have sanctioned already about 84 lakhs. Nearly 48 lakhs of 50 lakhs have been grounded, and 24 lakh homes have been handed over. Now, I want to refer to, you know, this kind of misreporting or cynicism is no longer very widespread, but I do see occasional examples of it. I saw a report in a Sunday paper and saying, you know, but government has to build 1 crore homes, it has only handed over 24. I mean, anybody who has even a nodding acquaintance with this area knows that in something like affordable housing, the most important step in the long chain is the making available land. Once you have the land identified, the rest follows very quickly. Let me explain to you how I see the average across the country. Once a state government has identified the land, then they go around looking at the embryo of a project, and that's when the state monitoring committee will come to us. If we have sanctioned 84 lakhs or 8.4 million, and we are in the process of sanctioning 200 to 300,000 every month, it means the land is available. After the sanctioning, the grounding follows pretty fast. But once the grounding is done, the technology you're using, it's 18 months or so. So if the number of homes sanctioned is 8.4 million, you've got 4.8 million already grounded, which means by the time you're in December, this 4.8 figure may go up quite a bit, but the 24 lakhs handed over will become 50 lakhs. Because once the process starts, it doesn't stop there. We had an issue on finance in between, and I can report to you that sometime around February of 2018, I went to the Prime Minister as a concerned new minister, and I said, this is such a big project, but the outlays we are getting in the budget of something like 6,000 crores, 6,500 crores, this is not going to take us very far. Now, you never go to the Prime Minister just with an anxiety. You have to go with him with a plan. So the plan we went on is to look at country resources and funding, and the good news is we succeeded. Now, I don't think any minister can turn around and say that, you know, we have all the money. No, every time we need to get 10,000 crore from here, but we have a framework within which we can access money and then we utilize the budgetary available to service that. So if you look at what needs to be done, I think Rajiv was reading out some statistics on how much urban space we have to build every year. All I can tell you is that McKinsey Global Institute report, I read somewhere a figure that they have said that we need to spend US dollars 1.2 trillion by 2030 to meet the projected demand of the city's infrastructure alone. Now, one of my earlier tutors, whom I find sitting here, Jagan, when I started my thing in the ministry, he and I used to talk about this. And the fact of the matter is that it's not just you take this as static and then you build. 70% of the India of 2030 has to be built. A lot of this is going to be redevelopment. So the opportunity this offers to the real estate sector is huge. But I again make another point. This time when you seize this opportunity, I think you will be doing it on much firmer ground. Because with RERA in place, some of the deviations or aberrations which we used to have of people taking money from home buyers, diverting it to purchase of land, I think that's a thing of the past. And I think the cleanup process which is taking place now is going to ensure that we have a much more stable, predictable, and transparent workplace. Now, I want to come to, I won't spend too much time on RERA. I have a prepared speech, but I have another meeting to go to. I want to say that from my point of view, RERA has been a resounding success, which is not to say that we've solved all the problems. In some states, I have always singled out Maharashtra, Madhya Pradesh, others, RERA has done exceptionally well. But in any piece of legislation, which is barely a year or two old, to expect that all the problems will be resolved is, I think, also somewhat fanciful. In fact, when RERA was established, those who were not happy about the idea of RERA said, well, it doesn't go far enough. I mean, their motivation may have been different. They mounted a challenge. The issue went to the Mumbai High Court. I was very confident it would come out. RERA is here. RERA is to stay. The reports I get from many states today suggest that RERA is beginning to have an effect. When I look at the number of problems that the RERA dispute resolution framework has resolved, the figure is very impressive. We still need to iron out a lot of things. We need to ensure that the, you know, that we don't veer between extremely lax and extremely rigorous and biting sort of thing. I mean, the whole idea was to put in place a regulator, which in and of itself, to do after 70 years is a great achievement. But the regulator now has come to be accepted both by the stakeholders and the those who felt that they were victims of the system. I am confident that the 2022 target, which the Honorable Prime Minister has set for housing for all, that for every Indian to have a home wherever he or she lives, for this to be a pakka home with a kitchen, with a toilet, and for the title to be in the name of the lady of the house, this target is not only going to be met, it's going to be met 2 to 3 years in advance. In fact, I'm confident that by December or January, this entire 1 crore target, which was the original demand assessment we'd done, that will be met. By March, I think that 1 crore, 12 lakhs will also be done. And during the course of the year 2020, the grounding and all that will be completed. So a good 2 years in advance, we can hope to have the Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana targets met. And if you look at that in consultation with the progress that we have made on the Swachh Bharat mission, both in terms of physical targets, in terms of the number of individual household toilets that we had to build, the community and public toilets. But more than the physical toilets, the behavioral change which has come as a result of this project of the government becoming a project of the people, a Jan Andolan, I think that's the good news. But we are not stopping at that. We are now going to ODF Plus, ODF Plus Plus. We are also going in terms of fecal sludge management, and I think the sanitation campaign is going very well overall. I have already covered rental housing. I should also like to say something about the streamlining of procedures. You periodically hear reports about, India gaining 50 ranks in the overall ease of doing business. Much of these improvements have very much to do with the housing sector, online building permissions, which are now becoming the norm rather than an exception. Use of technology. Look, let's face it, anyone familiar with the construction industry, and I believe all of you have more about the construction industry than maybe the rest of the world put together. But anybody knows that the toxicity that buildings produce using older technologies is responsible at least for 40% of the carbon emissions. So if you use newer technologies, and which we are doing now, you can not only produce better, more affordable housing, but you're also contributing to the survival of the planet. Therefore, the Prime Minister had, we had launched the Global Housing Technology Challenge in January 2019, and I'm very happy to inform you that progress on this has been very good. The Prime Minister has declared this current year, starting April 2019, as Global Technology in Construction. So again, this shows you the kind of overall emphasis that there is in the area of construction industry for ease of living. I just want to spend a minute or two on the smart city project. I'm very clear that as we proceed towards an overall urban rejuvenation, and I just want to give you some figures, I hope I get them correct. In the 10 years of the Congress-led UPA government between 2004 and 14, the total urban expenditure on a rejuvenation, if I may call it, was 1,50,000 crores or thereabout in 10 years. In the 4 years since the Modi government's flagship programs were introduced, which is from June 2015 to June 2019, the figure has been six times higher in 4 years. It's something like 960,000 crores as against 150,000 crores. So that gives you an idea about what this is. I could easily try to impress you that our cities today are not only contributing to a very large bulk of our GDP, they are also to our tax returns, etc. So the new mindset that the Prime Minister and his policies have introduced vis-a-vis the urban space, that itself is something quite remarkable. And I think our smart cities project, let me just say that when I became a minister in September 2017, the total amount of money for which contracting had been done was about 18,000 crores. Today, that figure is close to 140,000 crores. We have command and control centers operating in 16 of our cities. I am hopeful that by December, 50 of these cities will have command and control centers, and the physical manifestation of these, at least 50 of these 100 smart cities, you will begin to see in the coming few months. So I think all in all, we have a very good story to tell. I'm not trying to impress all of you because you know more about this sector than I do, but I think one of the good developments has been that government has been able to work with the industry and representatives of the industry like yourself in order to further that ecosystem so that at the end of the day, the consumer, the home buyer, will benefit from that. And I think that is something where I'm very confident that with the developments which have taken place as a result of developments in three of the large projects with the court, Honorable Supreme Court's intervention, I think we are seeing light at the end of the tunnel there itself. And I think at the end of the day, just as you need buyers for your products, the buyers need somebody who has to build those products. So I think that overall system is now entering a very mature phase, and I see a turnaround in this sector. So on that happy note, let me thank you all very much. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir, for throwing light on the way forward and for being such a strong advocate of our issues and challenges. Thank you very much, sir. And now we would like to request Minister, sir, to kindly felicitate the representative from the Jaipur Development Authority. May I kindly invite you on stage? We would like to felicitate you here in the hands of our chief guest for the day, Honorable Minister. And also I would like to invite representative from Rajasthan Housing Board to join us on stage to be felicitated by Minister, sir. May I invite you to join us quickly on stage, please? Thank you. We have the representatives from Jaipur Development Authority and Rajasthan Housing Board. May we request you, sir, to kindly felicitate. May I also invite the representative from Karnataka board to kindly join us on stage very, very quickly. Thank you very much. The representative from Karnataka board to kindly join us very quickly on stage, please. Thank you very much. And now I would like to invite Shri Basant Bansal, Chairman M3M Group, to kindly join us on stage to felicitate our Honorable Chief Guest for the day, Honorable Minister of State, Independent Charge of Housing and Urban Affairs and Civil Aviation, and Minister of State for Commerce, Industry, Government of India, Shri Hardeep Singh Puri Ji. May I invite you again, Shri Basant Bansal Ji, to join us on stage. Thank you very much once again, Minister Sir, for taking out time from your very busy schedule and joining us here today to talk about the challenges faced by the real estate sector in the country today, and for being a very strong advocate of the policies that can be, you know, implemented to make enhancements in the sector. And now I would like to invite Mr. Rajan Bandhelkar, Vice President, West NAREDCO and MD for Honor Group, to kindly join us for the vote of thanks.
Friends, I know sir wants to go early. Sir, I will just take 120 seconds, not more than that. Sir, I will tell you, ki you all people are thinking ki NAREDCO is doing a great job. So the entire credit goes to our chief patron. The excess what sir gives us, all easing in RERA, GST, especially I will tell you, sir has taken utmost pain to take FM's meeting on Sunday morning. That too also, I know sir's busy schedule. Sir, I think sir may not be hardly ministry mein, Modi government ke ministry mein sare log 4 aur 5 ghante ke upar sote nahi hai, to unme sir bhi ek hai, ki jo itna kaam karte hain. Aur sabse badi sir ki khubi hai, कि सर के डिक्शनरी में नो शब्द है ही नहीं है और इम्पॉसिबल भी शब्द नहीं है. तो आप कोई भी काम लेके जाओ तो 100% वो होता है और होता है. सर, आवर टीम हैज टू मोर प्रॉब्लम. वन तो आई एश्योर देम ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ यू, दैट इज सिविल एविएशन. दे हैव गॉट ट्रिमेंडस प्रॉब्लम इन सिविल एविएशन. तो आई हैव ऑलरेडी ब्रीफ्ड सर ऑल्सो, तो यू पीपल कैन बी रेस्ट एश्योर्ड. In a less than 45 to 60 days, all the problems should be sorted out. Myself and Kishore Bhatija went and met yesterday, the secretary sir also. Sir, second Mumbai and major India area problem is of defense. So in defense lands, they are facing tremendous problem. Unfortunately, they have tried tremendous left, right, center. But now we know ki whom to catch first. So we'll make sir as our leader and we'll go forward and we get all the things sorted out. Second thing, sir, in RERA also, we have done maximum changes. Anthony Dissa sir is here. Gautam Chatterjee sir, you know ki the way they have worked in Maharashtra, as well as there are all authorities who are working left, right and center. There are some changes are required. We'll have to go to once again to the cabinet. We will sit across and make all the representation and give it to you. We request you to take it on a priority basis. So it would be very easy. The ease of doing business will come for all sectors. I would like to thank sir from bottom of my heart and request all of you to give a standing ovation to have such a wonderful gentleman in between us. As well as I want to thank Mr. P.K. Gupta being here. Thank you, sir.
Sir, we would very, very quickly like to request Mr. Rajan Bandhelkar to felicitate Mr. P.K. Gupta, our So Minister Sir is in the rush to leave, ladies and gentlemen. Ladies and gentlemen, everybody please be seated. We have the address by our guest of honor. He will be sharing with us the financial perspective. As you know, the real estate sector is facing a very big challenge of bridging the gaps in the financial sector. So we will be having a brief perspective shared by our guest of honor. May I request all of you to be kindly seated. Please be seated, ladies and gentlemen. We have another address to be made by our guest of honor for the day, Shri P.K. Guptaji, Managing Director for SBI, who is going to share with us the financial perspective. May I invite you, sir, to kindly share your thoughts with us. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together and welcome our guest of honor for the day, Managing Director for SBI, Shri P.K. Gupta.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, let me actually thank NAREDCO for organizing this particular conference at this juncture. You know, there has been a lot of debate going around about the slowdown in the economy. And I think when you talk of slowdown amongst the sectors that is generally being talked about, the real estate is one of the sectors where the slowdown has been seen. I hope that this conference will be able to come up with some issues. I think the minister has already spoken. There are some indicators that are already there. And you know, the steps which one is that the sector itself can take, the government can take, or maybe I can speak something from the banking side or the financing side of this, what can be done actually. As you know, as far as housing is concerned, SBI as a bank was a late entrant. We entered a little late, but once we entered, we had the advantage, one of our geographic reach. Right now, say we have 20,000 branches spread across the entire country and the large customer base. Plus, more importantly, was the innovation that SBI brought into the financing of housing loans that made SBI today the largest home loan provider in the country. Maybe I'll come to this in a moment, actually. I think a lot has already been talked about the importance of housing sector. I think the housing sector for the economy is very, very important. And if the economy revival has to happen, the housing sector has to play a very important role. You know, internally within the bank, when we look at, you know, the impact the sectors have on the other sectors, I think housing plays an important role. I think just to give you a list of the sectors that get impacted by the housing is something you're starting with steel, cement, construction, building material, furniture, household goods, and of course the employment. I think the number of people that are employed in the housing sector is so huge that the impact of this on the entire economy is very, very huge. The government, as was again said earlier, has a huge program in terms of housing for all by 2022. Plus, coupled with the ambition of a 5 trillion economy, if both of these have to be achieved, the housing sector again has to play a very, very important role. And unless we see a quick revival happening there, you know, for both of these roles to be achieved will be very difficult. The minister already talked about in terms of housing for all 2022, the progress that has already been made. And we are almost probably getting there in terms of achieving that. So that will definitely help in achieving the overall target of a 5 trillion economy for the country also. Another sector which is actually linked with the housing, which has been under a bit of a stress at this point of time, is the NBFC or the housing finance companies. Now, one reason which is attributed by many for the slowdown in the housing also is the financing that was being done by the HFCs and the NBFCs. Many of them have been facing some issues for the last few months, because of which the flow of finance from some of these companies to the housing has slowed down. And many believe that this has resulted into lower demand for the housing itself, actually, and has contributed to the slowdown that has happened. Now, you know, as far as the banks are concerned, if you look at it, most of these NBFCs or housing finance companies are also funded by the banks in a very large measure. There is a lot of funding that goes to them from the banks also. From the bank side, what I can say is that as a bank, we didn't stop funding the NBFCs or the housing finance companies. There are very large, good, well-run HFCs and NBFCs who have continued to raise money from the banks, and the bank has been providing money to them. In some cases, yes, for the bank, there would have been prudential limits which would have got exceeded, because of which flow of credit to some of them could have actually become a little less. But then, you know, all NBFCs and HFCs were not the same. There are companies which had liquidity issues, there are companies which had ALM mismatches, and in case of some of the companies, I think there were serious concerns about the exposures they had to some of the sectors, which probably could threaten their ultimate viability also. So yes, some of them could have faced some issues, but I think the overall flow to the sector, as far as the banks are concerned, has continued to be good. This problem first surfaced sometime in the last year, September, October, when many of them found difficult to roll over their liabilities. I think that is the time again when SBI came up with the scheme to buy out the portfolios from many of the NBFCs and HFCs. We did actively pursue with many of them, bought quite sizable portfolios from them. In fact, SBI took the lead. We went ahead and in fact announced this program, and many other banks followed us and went ahead and bought those portfolios also, which in fact for the last 6 or 8 months eased a lot of liquidity issues which many NBFCs were facing. A few developments that have happened in the recent past which has actually allowed flow of credit to the NBFCs or HFCs through the banking sector also. One was the RBI came up with the scheme where they allowed the lower seasoning of loans by the HFCs. So the earlier the seasoning required to be done by a NBFC or a HFC before they could sell their portfolio to the bank was 12 months. So this was reduced to 6 months, because of which, again, many NBFCs could sell their portfolios to the bank and improve their liquidity position. Then RBI came up with this scheme of partial credit enhancement, and the banks could actually take the bonds issued by them, enhance them by offering their guarantee on them, and then they could raise the money from the market. But for some reasons, I think this scheme did not take off very well. There were probably one or two deals which only got done, because for the banks, I think there was issues around the capital that was required to be able to take advantage of this scheme. But two recent developments that has happened. One was in the budget speech, the finance minister announced about the partial guarantee by the government. A few days back, the guidelines for that have been announced. Up to 1 lakh crore of portfolios, the banks can buy from the HFCs or the NBFCs, where 10% guarantee will be given by the government for the first 2 years. The guidelines have just come. I think within the banks, we are still analyzing those guidelines. And once we have the internal board approved policies in place, so we should be able to take out some of these portfolios from the housing finance companies. The RBI announced recently a scheme for co-origination of loans for the purpose of priority sector lending. But unfortunately, the scheme which the RBI had announced was applicable only to the NBFCs which are classified by RBI as non-deposit taking and systematically important NBFCs. At that point of time, HFCs were not being regulated by RBI, they were being regulated by National Housing Bank. So the scheme as it stood at that point of time did not include HFCs. We have made a representation to the RBI saying that HFCs also could be included, so that some of those portfolios also could be funded by the bank, or the banks could actually work with the housing finance companies and co-originate housing loans. Because for some of the smaller housing loans, we found that many of the HFCs actually had better reach, and particularly the smaller value loans using technology could be much better originated through the HFCs. Now that the regulation of HFCs has moved from National Housing Bank to RBI, so I hope that this amendment to the scheme can also happen so that the banks can work with the housing finance companies to co-originate loans also. Another important development that has happened in this particular space is that RBI announced the banks funding the NBFCs for the purpose of on-lending to the NBFCs for on-lending for the purpose of priority sector lending. So as per the existing guidelines, there was a limit of 10 lakhs, which has been increased to 20 lakhs. RBI again has just announced the guidelines for this, which are being studied. So I think this would enable the banks, like instead of buying out the portfolios, where we can actually lend the money to them and they can originate the portfolios, keep it in their books itself, while the banks should be able to classify them as PSL in our books also. So I believe that all of these developments that have happened in the last few weeks would help the banks to be able to increase the flow of credit to the sector, both directly as well as indirectly through the housing finance companies or the NBFCs also. So I think, so I can take this opportunity to reassure all the builders saying that the finance probably will not be a problem as far as this sector is concerned. A few of the things that we as a bank particularly have done actually, and we can probably take pride in the innovations that we have brought. I think one of the studies which I read that, you know, when the global financial crisis happened in 2008-2009, it basically came out of the subprime crisis in the US, okay? But in India, we escaped that. So one of the reasons, as some study found out, was that the housing sector was one sector which actually did not suffer, and housing sector continued to grow. And one factor which enabled that was, if you remember at that point of time, SBI came up with a home loan scheme which was called the teaser home loans. Okay, so where we charged a rate of interest of 8% for the first 2 years, and the rate would get reset after 2 years. Subsequently, of course, there were some issues with the regulators, and the RBI did not allow that scheme to be continued, so we had to withdraw that. But, you know, coincidentally, if you look at the today's situation, today, for the first time, I think, again, you have a home loan rate which is very close to 8%. So we announced this home loan product, which is linked with the RBI's repo rate, and the rate for that gets set at 8.05% from the 1st of September. And the beauty of this particular product is that this is not dependent on the bank's MCLR, this is not dependent on any internal benchmark that the bank has. This is purely linked with the RBI's repo rate. So the moment RBI cuts the rate, the home loan rate automatically gets reset, okay? So you have, in 2008-2009, the home loans being offered at around 8% for first 2 years, and then getting reset after 2 years. And now for the first time, you have home loans being offered at a rate around 8%, not for the first 2 years, but it could be for the entire length of the home loan, actually. So you have a 25-year, 30-year loan, which could start at 8%. And now that, you know, we are talking about RBI actually bringing about more rate cuts, there is a general consensus that the rates could be cut by almost 40 basis points more during the current year itself. So this rate of 8.05 actually could come down to as low as 7.65% if the RBI goes ahead with these cuts. So I don't think in the history of this country that anybody could have ever taken a home loan at a rate as low as something between 7.5% to 8%. And this is the rate at which even the big corporates are not able to raise money. Okay, so this is the rate which is applicable only for the home loans. Again, there are reasons why the bank actually offer home loans at a rates lower than the rates at which probably we will lend to Mr. Hiranandani itself also. So the reason being that, one, there is risk weights that are assigned to the various loans that we give, actually. Okay, the risk weights to the corporates are dependent on the rating they get, actually, and accordingly, the banks have to maintain capital. Since the banks have to maintain lower capital on the home loans, so the benefit of that gets passed on in the form of lower pricing for the home loans. The second advantage, of course, is the priority sector lending targets that the banks have. So we need to meet that. So for the lot of the affordable housing particularly that we do, so when we do home loans at a lower rate, it helps us to meet that particular target also. Within SBI, I mean, we sanction somewhere close to 30,000 loans every month. About 2/3 of all the loans that we do are in affordable housing. And recently we did launch a digital product called YONO. So where, in fact, somebody could apply for a loan online, could get an in-principle sanction, he will know the amount of loan he can get, and once he goes and gives those documents to the bank, actually, and he should be able to get the loan very quickly. So another innovation that SBI brought in was about the max gain product, where you could actually keep your surplus money into your home loan account, and then you could save interest on your home loans also. So there is a lot of innovation happening. So I particularly are very excited about the repo-linked home loan that we announced. I think once we announced it, some of the other public sector banks also have recently announced. But I think the product that we have right now in terms of pricing and features both is particularly very good. So maybe you can go to our website and have a look at that also. And if you have any particular suggestions in terms of how we can improve this further, we'll be happy to do that. So I take this opportunity to again, you know, reaffirm the bank's commitment to support the sector, and we will continue to make available the home loans or the financing side of it, both directly, indirectly to the home loan either buyers or through the other financials who are there and who indirectly depend on us for the funding. So thank you very much for inviting me, and I wish you all the best for this conference.
Thank you very much, sir, for sharing the financial perspective with us. And now I would like to again invite Mr. Hiranandani to join us and share his thoughts. Please. Ladies and gentlemen.
Sir, I thank you and State Bank of India for being the biggest lender of home loans in India. Please give him a big hand. Number two, they have been the largest lender in terms of accessing those assets from NBFCs and being a participant in taking over many of those assets, which have actually saved the entirety of the NBFC sector, and they have been an important part of it. Number three, they've been always sponsors to our program, so please continue to do that also. Another part of the most important thing is that Mr. P.K. Gupta has given us a direction today that the home loan rates will continue to come down. The home loan rates will continue to come down. Please make a note of that, because it's going to be linked at the repo rate connectivity, and that's an important direction, which means that the lowest rate which was ever happened will now be met further, because RBI is expected to further reduce the repo rate, and this will happen automatically, which means not requiring any announcement by the Reserve State Bank of India or to take a decision. So we are extremely grateful for all those announcements which SBI has been made for the real estate sector. The developers also are very happy wherever you have been able to do the funds, whether rated or the other agencies that we are looking for. We are requesting, sir, that you should also take into consideration or give a proposal to the RBI for the purposes of taking stressed projects which require last mile funding, maybe on a LIFO basis, that means the last in, first out, could be for completion of the project, since the Supreme Court has also given directions in that way, which will actually save not only the lenders who have done it, buyers who have been doing it, but also possibility of completing the projects which are doing. So maybe SBI can come up with a plan which could be approved by government, finance ministry, RBI, in order to see that the 3 lakh houses, 2 lakhs plus in the national capital region alone could be funded by a LIFO method, by which the money could ultimately come back in terms of the financing which is going to be done, which will make a paradigm this is happening. And the last point is what happened in 2008. You mentioned about the Lehman crisis and how it did not affect to this extent. But if you recall, sir, there was a restructuring of loans which was provided in 2008, which actually provide for restructuring without calling an NPA to the industry. And I think time has come. We have talked to the Reserve Bank of India, but they say the banks are not asking for it. So if the banks ask for it, the Reserve Bank of India may be attuned to take up that issue so that unnecessarily more NPAs may not come on your balance sheet for a short-term funding issue which is really taking place into the industry. But all in all, State Bank of India has been a public sector par excellence. Mr. Sharma has been a wonderful executive who has made this paradigm happen. So we congratulate him for the excellence of management of there, which was not really known in the public sector. But State Bank of India has shown the exception to the rule in terms of being a fantastic PSU and a PSB, as they call it. And I wish them the very best. And thank you very much for the support. Please continue supporting this industry so that the Prime Minister's target of $5 trillion is also achieved. And you will have a greater and greater role to achieve that because you have the maximum amount of money to give it to us. Thank you very much, my friends. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. And now I would request Sri Rajan Bandhelkar ji to kindly felicitate our guest of honor for the day. May we please bring a token of appreciation. Ladies and gentlemen, we would like to thank Sri P.K. Gupta for his kind presence with us today, sharing the financial perspective. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you for gracing the occasion with your presence. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together for Sri P.K. Gupta.